Good morning to all students. I welcome you all to the first academic class for this session. I hope that you all have gone through the netiquette guidelines provided by the Blackboard. I would like to tell you that you must be present 15 minutes before the start of the class and you must carry the necessary stationery with you just to take up the notes that are given by the faculty during the lecture. And I would like to inform you that there is a in the middle center bottom of your screen there is a option of hand raise. You can just click that option and raise your hand, and in case you have any query you can also post a message in the chat box as we have done yesterday. I hope you are now comfortable with this platform and you will have a great learning experience with this platform. Okay, I would like to introduce myself. I'm Nitika Kapoor from the Department of Computer Science. I'm working as assistant professor in this department and I'm going to take up your subject of advanced data structures and algorithms. And please note the subject code for this subject is 20CST633. Okay, so let's get started with the course. So this is your first class. I would be first telling you about the learning, what are the learning outcomes of this course, course objectives, and we'll see what are the course outcomes, like what you will learn after going through this complete course, what would be the learning that you will gain. Okay, so you can just raise your hand in case you have any question. I'm just going to start with the lecture. I'm sharing the PPT now. Okay, so we are going to start with the subject of advanced data structures and algorithms. So as you can see that the name is advanced data structures, right? Advanced data structures and algorithms. So this is divided into two parts. Like first you will be studying the data structures which are advanced, like you have also studied this subject in your bachelor's level as data structures. Now in this subject we would be studying the advanced concepts of it, and the second part of the subject is algorithms. So we would be studying the algorithms as well. So we would be studying the advanced data structure and their related algorithms, and I hope that you have a basic understanding of this subject from your bachelor's level. And I also want to tell you one more thing. The important point is that this subject is very important from the point of view of placement. You get lot of questions when you sit in some placement drive. You get lot of questions from this subject. So please be attentive during the class, and I assure you that you will gain the basic knowledge as well as the advanced knowledge of this subject. So let's get started. In case I'm again repeating, you can just post your query in the chat box if in case of any problem. Let's move on. So we'll covering the course outcome first course outcome in this unit one. I'll discuss the course outcomes with you in the coming slides. Okay, so first of all, the first course objective, what is the objective of studying this course? Why we are studying this course? First of all, we are studying this course just to have understand the what is the role of algorithm in computer science and how we can practice those algorithms in computing. Yes, Dishant wants to say something. I'm just promoting you. Yes, Dishant.
Good morning, ma'am. The chat option.
Good morning.
In the chat option showing that it is disabled.
Let me check it. I'll just check it. You can just raise your hand. Okay, I will check it in the. Yes, I have enabled the chat option.
Another thing, will this PPT be available to us, or should we take down the notes?
Yes, the PPT is available to you in the Blackboard. The way you have logged into your Blackboard, the moment you open this course, you will see all the contents that are uploaded by me lecture-wise. They are the notes, I have also uploaded my handwritten notes. I have uploaded the content. I have given you the video links that you may go through for better understanding. I have given you the list of study material, like what is the suggestive reading book material. I have given the link for the online books also, like ebooks. You can just click on the link and the ebook will open for you. So everything is there in the course overview folder. There is a folder of course overview. You will find the syllabus over there. You will find the course objectives, outcomes, and you will get the brief introduction about me. And you will get the netiquette guidelines, that guidelines that you follow before when you are into the class. And there is lecture notes, and after every lecture, as I discussed yesterday, after every lecture, there would be a homework given to you that is already uploaded. So you need to do those questions. They are two questions, and they are non-graded. Like, you are not going to be graded for that, but you are supposed to do those homework questions. I hope, Dishant, this is clear.
Yes, ma'am.
In case of any query, you can just post a chat message in the chat box. This is for your information, that everything is uploaded on the Blackboard platform. Like, you logged into the session, you have clicked on my course, and in under that course, you will find the course overview folder. You will find a folder of unit 1, unit 2 and 3. So unit 1 contains the details of the lectures of unit 1. They are divided into three chapters. Chapter 1 covers the basic introduction about the data structure. Chapter 2 is about trees. And chapter 3 is the advanced data structures. So you can find everything in your folder. There are SCORM PPTs also. These PPTs have been uploaded in your Blackboard platform. Dishant, I still have, you have some query because you have raised your hand. Okay, fine. So moving on, we were discussing the course objectives. First objective is why we are studying this subject, just to have the understanding how the algorithms are can be used in science and how we can use it in computing. Second objective of this course is after studying this course, we have to gain familiarization with different algorithm design techniques, that how we can design an algorithm. There are various type of algorithm designing techniques, so you will be learning this also from this course. And you will be learning the problem solving techniques for the engineering and the related problems. And you will also study their performance. You will also be studying how a particular algorithm is performing. Okay. So this is the course objective. This course is designed to cover up these objectives. And the outcomes are like what you will gain after this course. What would be the outcome after completing this course? First of all, you will get the basic and advanced data structure knowledge and the related algorithms. You would be gaining the knowledge on the basic data structure and the advanced one, and what are the various algorithms related to those data structures. Then you would be also learning the algorithm complexity, how to calculate the complexity of a particular algorithm and how to analyze it in various searching and sorting techniques. And the third outcome for this of this course would be that you will learn where to apply the dynamic programming approach for problem solving. There are various problem solving approaches, like we have greedy approach, dynamic approach. So you would be learning where to apply which approach for solving a particular problem. Okay, I hope this is clear, that these are the outcomes after completing this course, you would be gaining this knowledge. Okay, now, before moving on to the course content, I would like to have an activity among you people, just to have the better understanding why we are studying this subject. The main question among you would be, why we are studying this subject? Why this advanced data structure has been included in our curriculum? So I would like to make this thing more clearer by having an activity among yourself. So I would be asking you some question. You need to just raise your hand. Okay. Okay. My question is, you are given a list of names over here on the screen. You have to quickly answer the position number of Boris Johnson? Quickly, you have few seconds with you. Just answer, where is Boris Johnson? This is a activity for you. You will learn how to relate the subject. Yes, Chavi. Yes, Chavi. Yes, everyone is answering. Yes, the answer is right. It's in male 14. Yes, very good. I've got. Yes. Very nice. You people are very attentive and listening to me very carefully. Okay, fine. The answer is the male name exists on the 14th number. The Boris Johnson is on the 14th number in the male list. Yes, right. Now, what do you observe out of it? First of all, the names of males and females were not ordered. Are they in order? Just check. They are not in order. They are jumbled. They are unsorted in nature. Yes, and they are not in order. Yes, I'm getting the reply of everyone. Very good. So they are not in order, and it took some time to you to search for that particular person in the list. Am I right? Yes, we took some time to search that person in the list and assume that if this is a small list, assume that the list contains lack of persons, then what would happen? You would just go crazy searching for a particular name in the unsorted list, which contains the lack numbers of the and lack names of the persons. Yes, this is a tedious job for us. So data structure comes into the picture over here. See, data structure is the way your data is organized in the memory. First of all, I would like to tell you that there are two type of memories in your bachelor's level. You might have started this. We have primary memory and we have secondary memory. Okay, the data which is currently we are working on resides in the primary memory. Okay, now if I have lack of data with me and it is not in any order, it is jumbled in nature or it is unsorted in nature, and I ask you to search in that data, would be difficult for you. Definitely it is going to be difficult for you. So data structure comes into the picture over here. Data structure is, if the data is not organized in any structure, it is not following any structure, or it is not in any pattern, then it is going to be difficult for you to apply any operation on that data structure. Am I right? Yes, you can just raise your hand in case. Yes, very good. So data structure is how the data is being organized. In the, if the data structure would be missing from our computer, if our system or memory is not following any data structure, applying any operation on that data would be very difficult, and it would be very tedious and time consuming. Just to save the time, our data must be in some organized manner and it should be arranged in some particular pattern. So that's where the data structure comes in. So that's why we are starting this subject, because we need to store our data in a particular organized fashion. So this activity just tells you that what is the need of data structure and why we are starting this subject. I hope this is clear. Let's move on to the contents of the lecture. Okay, now what we would be studying in this lecture, what are the objective of this lecture, what I want to cover up in this lecture is, I would be discussing various data structures that are available with us and what are the properties of those data structures, and also we would be studying that where those data structures are being used in real life example. Like if we talk about array structure, you might have studied this in bachelor's, where they are actually being used in real world. So we will look at the applications of those data structures. And what would be the outcomes after this? What you will learn after this lecture would be, first of all, you will learn what is the need of this subject. We have just seen that why we are studying this subject. You will also learn what are the various data structures and their real life application. What is the strength of each data structure and what is the weakness of each data structure and how they differ from each other. And we will also cover the various operation possible on any data structure. Okay. Okay. Yes, I'm getting the response of each one of you, and it is good that you people are very attentive in my class. Okay, so these are the contents that I've already discussed with you. Now moving on to the contents. What is data? See, if I say 1, 2, 3, I say Ajay, I say block 1 or something like this, the information does not convey, this thing does not convey any information to you. The data is nothing but a raw data, raw facts and figures, which is not processed. If I say 123, can you judge what is 123? It can be a roll number also, or UID also. It can be 123, can be the amount to be paid to the shopkeeper also. So the, when I say something and I'm not associating it with some label, that is just a data, means it is meaningless for me. But when I say your roll number is 123, it becomes an information. Information means it is conveying a particular thing to me, that yes, 123 is a UID of some student or the roll number of some student. I say Ajay, you don't know what is Ajay. He may be a person, but he may be a administrator, he may be a block in charge, he may be anyone. If I say name of our block in charge is Ajay, that becomes an information for you. So when the data is in raw form, you can see over here in the diagram, you can see the data is in raw form. When we process it, we label it, we get an information. Okay, fine. So this is what is data, how the data is different from information. Data is a raw facts and figure, and information becomes when we process it and label that data, that becomes an information. This is the basic thing that you must know. Okay. Then moving on, what is data type? Now you all must have done programming in C, C++. Data type, if you have to store something into a variable, that variable must belong to some data type. Like it can be an integer if it is number. Like if I have to store 1, 2, 3, I must take it as integer. If I have to store A, B, C, I must take it in a character array. So data type belongs to what kind of value is being contained by that variable. That is data type. And various data types available to us is integer, float, character, and many more. You have already gone through this. I'm just recapitulating the things. Okay, now again, what is data structure? How the data type is different from data structure? Data type is the type of value that a variable can contain, and data structure is how the data is being arranged, or you can say the arrangement of your data in computer's memory or even disk storage. Disk storage is the secondary memory, and memory is your RAM in which you are currently working in. Okay. So, or we can also say that it is a logical and mathematical model of particular organization of data. Means I'm logically saying that, okay, if I say I'm talking about arrays, my data would be at one place. If I talk about linked list, my data would be scattered throughout the memory. So it is a model. See, array is a model which collects all the data at one place. Linked list is a model which actually scatters the data throughout the memory. So it is just a model. So data structure is nothing. It is a logical or mathematical model how your data is going to look or store in the memory. Okay. So in simple words, I would say that data structure is a particular way of storing and organize the data in computer, how the data is going to be stored in computer. And why we are discussing data structure, the main advantage of having the data structure is efficiency in performing the operations on the data. Like if the data would be unsorted or it would not be following any structure, then we won't be efficiently doing the operations on that data. So to improve the efficiency, I think you understand the word efficiency. Efficiency in terms of time, it can be space also. Efficiency is how quickly you can perform any operation, right? So yes, I'm getting the reply of everyone. Okay, good. So the data structure is very necessary for any computer system. That's why we are starting this subject. Okay. Now, the data structure can be categorized under two categories. One is the linear data structure. Second is the non-linear one. As the name suggests, that the linear means something in a particular fashion, one after the another. And non-linear means which is not following the linear fashion or the single line fashion. So linear data structure is a data structure when we organize the data in a linear fashion. By linear fashion means that every item or every data item would have one predecessor and one successor. By predecessor means the item before it, and by successor I mean to say the item after it. So there would be, if I talk about a data item X and it is a linear data structure, if it is stored in a linear data structure, there would be single item that would be appearing before it, and there would be a single item that would be appearing after it. So that means that is a linear data structure. When we are following the structure, that data structure is a linear data structure. And I'll just read out the definition for you. The data structure is said to be linear if the elements form a sequence, means they are in particular sequence. Okay, the example of this data structure, linear data structure, are: first is array. You might have heard about this and implemented this also in your bachelor's. Second is linked list. Third is stack and queue. These are the various examples of linear data structure. We would be looking at their details in the coming slides. Okay, since our lecture is more focused on what are the data structure, various types of data structure, and what are the strengths and weakness, and what are the applications of various data structures, so we would be covering it. Okay, then next type of data structure is non-linear one. As the name suggests, it is saying there would be no linear fashion, there would be no sequence, the elements would be stored in, they won't be following any sequence to be stored. That is non-linear data structure. Or you can say, if I have an item X which is stored in a non-linear data structure, it might have two predecessors, or you can say, or more than two values in it before it, and it might have more than two or three successors. So there is no linear fashion being followed in non-linear data structure. I hope this is clear. And example of this is tree and graph. Let me take one example for the tree. Yes, very good, you people are responding. In the end of the lecture, I'll be asking you a poll question. I'll just brief you about what is poll. Poll, you will be seeing a kind of yes and no option on your screen, or multiple choice questions answers on your screen. You just need to click as per your reply. Then I'll get the reply from your side, and I can see those who have replied and those who have not replied. And one more option is available. Can we have some example? Okay, Binay want to know the example of my non-linear one or the linear one. Binay, please reply. You want to have the example? Both. Okay, I'm just giving you. Okay, I'll just give you the example of both. Fine, got it. And I was just briefing you about this, that there is an option of feedback in the bottom center of your screen, that you can even give your feedback, like if I'm going very fast or if I'm going very slow, or you are confused about a particular topic, you can just click on that. I'll see your feedback. Yes, you people are posting the feedback now, right? Okay, so as per the question, asked by Vinay, he wants to have the example of linear data structure. Example of linear data structure is arrays. For example, let me share a whiteboard with you for. Okay, what is linear data structure? Linear data structure, if I take the example of array, see, they are in a linear fashion. As I have discussed, that they are in linear fashion. Suppose this is your memory. Okay, so this is your memory and it is divided into cells. Now if I talk about storing the data in the form of array, that data would be stored at a consecutive memory location. Consecutive means contiguous means continuous. Okay, so if I have few numbers to store, 10 20 30, if I am storing these numbers and I'm storing it in a linear data structure of arrays, so they would be stored as 10 would be stored, and after that 20 would be stored, and after that 30 would be stored. So this is how the linear data structure or array is going to store the elements, and this would be labeled under one variable name. Name that array as A. So you can assess the, you know that there are indexes associated with every array element, and this would be 0, 1 and 2. So index number 0 would contain the element at the first index. Index number 1 would contain the element at the second index, and index number 2 would contain the third element. Okay. So this is how the array is going to store, or you can say the linear data structure is going to store. Means linear data structure is going to store the element one after the another. First 10 would be stored, then 20 would be stored, then 30 would be stored. I hope this is clear. Then moving on to the example of nonlinear data structure. I discussed the example of data structure, nonlinear one is tree. Now what does this tree means? Tree in general sense, you know what is a tree? There is a root, there is a branch, and there is a trunk and there are branches. So this is how your tree look like, and there are fruits to the tree. Now in our computer terminology, we have tree. Let me draw a tree like this. Let's take example of your family. On the top of your family, who is there? Is your grandparents. Let us say you have your grandparents. Okay. And who is the descendant of grandparents? Your parents. So, okay, your parent, or you can say the descendant of your grandparents are your father and your uncle. Okay. And now you have your mother as well. Mother is over here, and the descendant of father and mother is you and your brother or sister. So this is a kind of like one grandparent may have more than two children, or father, mother, father, uncle, aunt. You may have more than one descendant of grandparents, and you have more than one descendant of your parents, you, your sister, your brother. So there is not a single relationship. There is a you can say more than one relationship. It is not fixed that the predecessor of father would be single grandparent. Your grandmother would also be there. And it is not fixed that there would be a single son or daughter of your father. There may be more, like you, your sister, your brother. So the relationship is not like in our previous example, as I discussed, that there was 10, 20 and 30. So there was a single relationship, like 20 was having one predecessor and one successor. But the case over here is not the same. Your father may have more than one predecessor, that is your grandfather and grandmother, and your father may have more than one successor, like you, your brother, your sister. I hope this is clear. You can just reply yes. Okay. So I hope this is clear. We are moving further with our slides. I'm just switching over to the slides. Okay. Fine. So we have seen the example of these two, linear data structure and nonlinear one. And now moving on to what are the various operations that can be performed on any data structure. See, obviously when you are storing the data, you need to perform some operations on it. You might need to add something to it. You might need to delete something from your data. You might need to search for a particular element in your data. You might need to sort that data. So there are various operations that can be performed on given data structure. And the very first operation, we are going to discuss some of the operations over here. First operation is traversing. What does this mean? Traversing means traveling, or you can say assessing each element once. Assessing each record present in your data structure once is called traversing. For example, if I take the example of our previous array, if I have to traverse this array, so I would be visiting 10 once. Then I would be visiting 20, then I would be visiting 30. Or you can say in computer terms, if we talk about visiting means we will be printing it. This is how we can visit. Okay. So for when you are programming, when you are printing each element once, that is traversal. So I hope this is clear. Then as searching. What do you mean by searching? Searching means looking for a particular element in the given data structure. If I say I'm looking for 40 in this given data structure, so I'm searching 40 in this, means I'll first compare 40 with 10, then I'll see if it is compared with 20 and 40 will be compared, then 30 and 40 would be compared, and in the end I will come to know that the element is not present. So searching is finding the location of a particular record, means I'm finding the location of 40 in the given data structure. Okay, that is searching. So finding location, what would be the location of 10? I've already discussed the index value of 10 is 0, index value of 20 is 1, and index of 30 is 2. So if I'm searching 40, 40 would return me that the search is unsuccessful. Yes, search is unsuccessful. Yes, you people are replying in the chat box, I can see. Okay, then as inserting, what do you mean by inserting? Inserting is adding some element to your data structure, that is inserting. Okay, then comes deleting. Deleting is removing the data structure, the item from your data structure is deleting. If I want to delete 20, I'll just remove 20 from here. So that is deleting. And then the next operation that can be performed is sorting. Sorting means you are arranging your data in the given data structure. You are arranging it in a particular fashion, like in ascending order or descending order. So there are two orders, either ascending or descending. So if you are storing the data in either of these orders, that means you are sorting your data. Then is merging. Merging means that combining, merge to combine two different or the sorted data structure into a single data structure, you can say. You are given two similar data structure, you can merge them to form a third type of data structure. Okay, I hope this is clear. You can merge two arrays to form a linked list. Okay, so this is various operations that we can perform on data structure. Traversal, searching, sorting, inserting, deleting, and merging. So, and whenever we would be studying various data structure, we would be studying these operations, how these operations are going to be performed on every data structure that we are going to study. Basically, we would be studying every data structure, and we would be writing algorithms for applying these operations on those data structures. Okay, so you need to remember these operations and what operation is performed when. I hope this is clear. Let's move on. Yes, okay. So everyone has responded. You people are understanding it very well. Okay. So moving on to the very first data structure, that is array. What is array? See, what is why the array is required? I give you one task and you have to respond. Okay. See, I say that I have or you have to store the marks of 60 students of the class in some variables. What you will do? One thing is you will create a variable A, B, C, D, up to 60 variables. You need to create 60 variables so that they can store 60 values. The another better alternative or the option with us is to create array. Array is the solution to this problem. Like when you have to store same type of values, multiple values but of same type under a single name, then the array comes into the picture. Okay, so array is a variable that enables you to store multiple values of same type under a single name or a single variable name, that is array name. I hope this is clear. Okay, so when you are storing a list of finite numbers of similar items, similar data items, if you are storing numbers, you need to create an array of numbers. If you are storing floats, you need to create the array of floats. Okay, and these array elements would be stored at the consecutive place. They would be stored at a continuous memory space, and those memory space, or you can say those indexes or the positions, are indexed, and they are indexes 1, 2, 3 and n. See, if I talk about a particular language like C++, Python or C, then this array index starts from 0. Every language has a different indexing system. Okay, so we are keeping it in general that it starts from 1. If I talk about language specific, in Python, it is it is going to start from zero. For C++, it is going to start from zero. For Java, it is going to start from zero. The array indexing starts from zero in these languages. And the array indexing starts from one in Pascal, languages like Pascal. Pascal stores the array from the index number one. Okay. So we are keeping it a journal because this is a journal subject and you can implement it in any language. So the array indexes start from 1 and up to n. Now what is this n? N is the index value of the last variable. If there are n numbers in your array, it would be the index value. Okay. Let us please mute yourself. I don't know why the voice is echoing. Okay, so the array is a collection of elements of similar type, right? Now moving on further, and see the array. If I name my array as A, followed by the square brackets, you can mention the subscript value over here. You can mention 1, you can mention 2, you can mention 3. If you're mentioning 1, it means I'm assessing the index value, the value present at index number 1. Okay. If I write A of 2, then it means I'm assessing the value at the index number 2. Let me demonstrate this on the whiteboard. It would be more clear. Okay. Let us say, this is your array, okay? See, you can extend it or let me go ahead. See, this is your array. I've already discussed that the array is stored at a contiguous memory location and it has a variable name. Means I name my array as A, you can name it as A, B, C, whatsoever. You can keep your name as the array name. Hardly matters. It has to be a name. Like the same naming convention is to be used as for variables. Okay. Now it is being stored in the memory. Definitely every cell has a memory address. Since we are not dealing with memory addresses, virtually the array has the indexes also. Like this is 0 in case of C++. This is 1, this is 2, and this is 3, and so on. This is 4. If I say that A of 0 means I am talking about the element which is stored at the 0th index, and that would be, let's say 10. Now, if I say A of 1, I'm talking about the element which is stored at index 1. Let us say I have stored 20 over here. I have stored 30, 50. 60. Let's say A2 means, let me take your question. Anupam has a question. A of 2 means the element at the position 3, index starts from, yes, definitely. Exactly, Anupam, you are right. Okay, so let us say this is my array. In general, I'll say that array starts from 1, but I'm taking the example of Python or C++, you can say. Okay. If I say the 0th index, I'm talking about the first element. If I say the first index, I'm talking about the second element. If I say it's the second index, I'm talking about the third element. And if there are n elements in my array and my array started from 0 index, so the indexes would go from 0 to n minus 1 definitely. See, over here I have 6 numbers. They are going from 0 to 6 minus 1, that is 5, right? So my array is starting from 0 and it is ending up to 5. If there are n elements in my array, the array would index would start from 0 and it would go up to n minus 1. And also, if I have to assess a particular element, I will simply write A of I and I will get that particular element directly. This is the advantage of arrays. See, I'm while going through a topic, I would be giving you the advantage, strengths and weakness of that data structure as well. So you keep in mind these things. So So when I say A of I, I can directly read that element. This is the main advantage of data structure. They gives us the advantage becomes that they gives us fast assess. They are very fast in assess. If I have to assess any element, I need not assess all the elements before this. If I have to assess this element, I'll simply do A of 3 and I'll get 40. I need not read first element, then second element, then third, and finally reach the third index. No, this is not required. Your array can allow the direct assess. So this is the second advantage of your arrays. Arrays allows you direct assess. You can directly jump to a particular element in the array. Now, how the arrays are providing this direct assess, there is a formula behind the picture. I'll just tell you that formula also in the coming slides. Actually, there is a formula being and then you are actually jumping or assessing directly particular element. There is behind the scene, the formula is there and we will be discussing that formula, and also I'll give you some problems to solve that particular kind of things. Okay, so moving on to our slides now. Just a second, I'm just switching over to the slides. Okay. So this is what we have studied. Linear array is a one-dimensional array, and we can store the similar type of elements in it. Arrays are indexed. They are indexed from 0 to n minus 1, or in general, they are indexed from 1 to n. And this square is called A of k. If I'm writing a variable in this way, this is called the subscripted variable also. In some books or terminology, you will find the subscripted variable. Okay, moving on. I'll just brief you about, I've already given you the two advantages of array. First is, see, the advantage over here is written. Fast assess, it gives us fast assess and it gives us direct assess also. We need not go in a it gives us a random assess. We need not go in a sequential fashion. Okay, we need not read all the elements before a particular element. We will directly jump to read a particular element by using the array index of that element. Okay, so the basic features of array is it can hold multiple values under a single name, and they are referenced by array name and an ordinal index. I said ordinal. What do you mean by ordinal? The word ordinal is like in 0, 1, 2, 3, increasing fashion. So array has an ordinal index. Means array has 0, 1, 2, 3 and so on. They have index values. And they are referenced. Elements are referenced by the index. Yes, we have also seen that. Okay. Every element has a value. Array indexing starts at 0. In C or C++ or Python. Okay, they are stored at a contiguous memory location. They are stored in a contiguous memory location, like they are stored at one place, one after the another. Okay, one more important term associated with the array is a term called base address. As I've discussed that there is a formula behind the scene. So this thing is used for calculating or reaching a particular element in the array, directly jumping to a particular element in the array. Now, what is base address? Base address is the address of the very first element of the array. If I say array name is A and it starts at the 1000 position in the memory, my base address would be 1000. Okay, let's have a quick poll now. Let's have it. You can see a poll on your screens. Just a second. I'm running a poll. You just need to say yes and no. Click yes and no. Yes, I've started the poll. Please start answering. Yes, yes. Very good. There are 46 members that are connected with us in class, and 36 have responded, and 9 students have given no response. Yes, 5. Non-respondents are 5. quickly I'm stopping the poll just to see that are you having understanding of the topic. I'm just running this poll. Yes, still two students have not responded, and I'll see those who have not responded. Yes, Shavi, please respond. Yes, you have responded. Avneet Kaur has not responded. Avneet Kaur, please do respond. So I'm stopping the poll. There are two students, those who have not responded. So this is how you will be looking at the poll, and you will be responding to my questions. So the poll would be appearing on your screen, and I would be checking at the responses given by you. Okay, fine. So moving on to the topic, we were discussing the base address. Base address is the starting address of the array. Okay, where the array is being stored in your the very first element, address of the very first element in the array. Okay. So let's move on. So this I have already discussed. This is how your array will look like. Data of 1 is equal to 247, means data is the name of my array, 1 is the index location of my array, and 247 is stored over there, right? Data of 2 equal to 56 means the data is stored at the second index location and its value is 56. Okay, so this is how your data would be looking or being stored in the linear array, right? So we'll move on with the next topic of linked list in the next lecture. I hope you have understanding of linear arrays in this topic. We have a problem to be solved. Let's moving on. Let's concluding. Yes. Where will be the homework visible in the blackboard? See, I've already discuss under the particular course, you will have a unit. Within the unit, there is a chapter 1.1, and within chapter 1.1, you will see lecture 1 homework. You need to attend homework. Okay. Before concluding the topic, I would ask you people to solve the problem which is given over here. Yes. It's visible in lecture 1 homework, right? Yes. Yes. Okay, fine. I think we need to discuss this formula for computing. I do not want you to just cram this formula. I'll be discussing the logic behind this formula, and then we will be solving the problem. So that's all for today. I hope you had a great learning experience for today lecture. Okay, Avneet want to ask something. Ma'am, from where I can find timetable? Timetable is visible in your CUIMS account. Please log into your CUIMS account, and there would be option of my timetable. You just click on that and you will find the timetable over there. Okay. Timetable is visible in CUIMS and WhatsApp group. Yes, I have posted on the WhatsApp group also and in the CUIMS. Fine. So let's conclude this session. In this session, we have learned what is the need of this subject, what are the various, what is data structure, what are the various type of data structure. We have seen example of each of these, and we have seen what are the linear arrays and what are the advantages, why arrays are the better solution for storing similar type of elements, and what are the advantages of this. In the coming lecture, I'll tell you what are the disadvantages of the array, and we would be solving this formula, and we'll see the related problems to this formula. Fine. So that's all for today. I hope you have understood everything.